little things that are bothering you go for a moment. We have three songs to sing this morning before we get started. And you probably know all of them because none of them are new. Okay? So it's going to be really important that you sing much louder than me. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave. From the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Holiness, holiness is what I long for. Holiness is what I need. Holiness, holiness is what you want from me. Faithfulness, faithfulness is what I long for. Faithfulness is what I need. Faithfulness, faithfulness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Take my mind, transform it. Take my will, conform it to yours, to yours, O Lord. Righteousness, righteousness is what I long for. Righteousness is what I need. Righteousness, righteousness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Take my mind and transform it. Take my will, conform it gonna sing Holiness again. Holiness, holiness is what I long for. Holiness is what I need. Holiness, holiness is what you want from me. So take my heart for me. Take my mind, transform it. Take my will, conform it to yours, to yours, O Lord, to yours, to yours, O Lord. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things grow strangely dim in the light of his glory. Father God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for who you've made us to you. We praise you. We praise you for all the things that you've done for us. And I pray that you would draw us closer to each other and closer to you. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
So I don't think it counts as me doing both parts of the service if I wear a mask down there and then I take it off up here, right? Oh. Be honest with you, some of those higher notes are hard for me to get when I'm wearing a mask. They're hard for me to get when I'm not wearing a mask. I think it scares me a little. Anyway. Welcome. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted. So when I listened to Rob's sermon last week, I had a clear vision in my mind where I was going to go for roughly the next year and a half. And he kind of knocked me out of order, but in a good way, where one of the verses that he read just really stuck in my head. And as I was looking through where I'm planning to go, it would have come up in about a month and a half, just kind of as a sideline. But I'm like, no, we should spend some time here. That was John 3:14, which I just read in John 3:15. And what's interesting is I probably have spent about somewhere between 6 and 10 hours actually on my sermon notes, which are sitting on my nightstand right next to the bed. So the good news is, I still have the text they were all based off of, so we'll be okay. But if you don't mind, I'll open us in prayer and I'll get started. I know I just prayed down there, but it's different. I took my mask off. Father God, I pray that you would give me the words to speak. I pray that you would open your word to people's hearts, and that we remember why we're coming together is about you. It's all about you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. So again, I'm going to go ahead and read John 3:14 and John 3:15. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. I love this way that Jesus speaks about himself. He compares himself to the snake in the desert. Now, just by a rough show of hands, how many of you remember the story of the snake in the desert? The serpent in the desert. Wonderful. Way better than half. But we're going to revisit that. And that's from Numbers 21, verses 4 through, I believe, 8 or 9. Yeah, through verse 9. So I'm going to go ahead and read that for you, and then I'll try to put it into context a little bit. They traveled from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea to go to Edom. But the people grew impatient on the way. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, "Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the desert? There is no bread, there is no water, and we detest this miserable food." Some translations say we detest this worthless food. When the Lord sent venomous snakes among them, they bit the people, and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned and spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us." So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, "Make a snake and put it up on a pole. Anyone who is bitten can look at it and live." So Moses made a bronze snake and put it up on a pole. Then anyone who was bitten by a snake looked at the bronze snake and he lived. Again, some of the translations say a fiery snake, which actually leads me to believe that it's like a Palestinian, I believe, wave viper, saw viper. They're actually bronze in color. And they have some red to them. They almost look like fire. And those are kind of indigenous to that area. They're highly venomous. That's a little nerdyology for you. You don't get extra points for knowing that. But so when Moses made this bronze serpent and put it up on the pole, it probably would have actually resembled the same color as the snakes themselves. But some of your translations say a fiery serpent. And this one just says a venomous snakes. But yeah. Anyhow, so when people were bitten, they were able to see that they had sinned against God and they had sinned against Moses. And they said, "Moses, we're wrong." And they actually repent of their behavior. And Moses says, okay, or Moses prays to God. And God tells him, "You put this snake on a pole and you put it up on the hill. And anyone that turns their eyes, that looks upon this snake, they'll live." And that's exactly what happens. Now, when we go back to John 3, we're seeing that Jesus is saying this of himself. Jesus is actually saying, just as the serpent was lifted up. Again, I know I've read it twice. I'm going to read it again and probably again later. "Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life." So that the people that had faith enough to actually look at this serpent on the pole didn't die. Everyone that refused to look and fix their eyes on this snake died. And Jesus actually uses this as an analogy for himself while he's still living. Excuse me. Now, to put a little context into when these people started complaining in the desert, because if you're like me, when you read Exodus and you read Numbers and you see these people complaining, you're like, what is wrong with these people? Over and over and over again. And they're exactly like us. That's actually what's wrong with them, is they're exactly like us. We don't remember what God did for us. Now, if it helps, this right here, when they're coming down off of Mount Hor, is 39 years into their exile, into their wandering around in the desert, which they did for 40 years. Aaron the priest has just died. This is not the same group of people that was brought out of Egypt. This is the group of people that heard the stories from their parents about what we left. I don't know if that'll help you have a little mercy on them in your minds, but this isn't even probably the same group of people. I heard a beautiful analogy from a pastor one time where he said that Moses' life can be cut into 40-year sections. The first 40 years, he lived in the Pharaoh's house and he thought he was somebody. The 40 years after that, he lived as a shepherd, learning that he was nobody. And then the last 40 years of his life, he is essentially an undertaker. Because everyone he brought out with him, from him from Egypt, they had to bury along the way. So this is a whole new group of people having the exact same argument their parents did near the beginning of their journey. And I think it's interesting that God has provided them for 40 years with food and with water from a rock. But what they don't have is they don't have the assurance that there's more behind them, because we're just like that. We like to see that we have enough food. We like to see our cupboards full. If you go into my house, our cupboards are so full, the doors are pushing out on some of them. Because that makes us feel secure, and it means I don't have to go to Walmart, which is worth its weight in gold some days. But I think we all have that. They couldn't see that they had enough food for tomorrow. They couldn't see that they had water for tomorrow, because the water was being provided as they went. And the food was being provided as they went. If they tried to store food for the next day, Scripture tells us that it actually rotted during the night and was full of, I believe, maggots. And the way it describes manna, and I hope this isn't sacrilegious, that this is exactly where my brain goes to, is all I can think of is kettle corn, the way they describe it. Having a taste of honey, it's just kind of lightly sweet and kind of bread-like. All I can think of is kettle corn. I'm not saying that God gave them kettle corn daily, but I love kettle corn. If I had to live on kettle corn for 40 years, I might get a little agitated. I think I would probably start to grumble a little bit too, because they're just like us. These are people. That's one of the things that I've just grown to love so much about Scripture. The older I get, is realizing that these are people like us, doing things that we still do in our relationship to God. Everything that we're reading about is stuff that I can see smaller examples or different examples of how I do the exact same behaviors. Another frame of reference is, like I said, this is 39 years into their exile. I know I haven't aged the best, but I'm 38. These people have been in the desert longer than I've been alive. I spent 13 months in the desert. No, thank you. That's a long time to be in the desert. But what's amazing, and something that they do see over and over again, though they need reminded, is that God has been taking care of them this whole time. God has provided for them every step of the way. It says their shoes don't even wear out. It's amazing. God meets their needs where they're at each and every day. And when they sin, the solution is that they need to turn their eyes where God tells them to. It's that simple. It's like, you really messed up. You should probably die. But instead, if you just turn your eyes here, lift your eyes up and fix them on what I told you to. I'm not trying to oversimplify this, but God already did it. He already made this very simple. Jesus actually likens himself to the serpent being lifted up in the desert. We know that sin separates us from God. We are already infected with venom. Honestly, if you need to wonder if you are poisoned, and I will say venom again, because I know if Dylan's here, he's going to hate when I call venom poison and poison venom. They're different. But we're already full of poison. We're already full of venom. If you need proof of that, go somewhere where no one's looking. Give yourself a few minutes. I'm not saying that everyone automatically starts thinking sinful thoughts, but if you're driving down the stretch of road and you're late, and you know there's no police there, you don't have to raise your hand. How many of you are going to push a little bit harder down on the gas pedal? Okay, someone actually did raise their hand. Thank you for your honesty. But I bet you majorly obey the laws of the land. Because we're told to obey the laws of the land, yet speeding doesn't always make the cut if you know you're not going to get caught. If someone pays you for something in cash and you know it's taxable, are we going to render to Caesar what is Caesar? Or are we going to just figure we already paid way too many taxes and no thank you? We're already full of venom. You can justify just about anything. But the solution is still the same. You fix your eyes on where God told you to, and you will live. And I went to John 12 after that, and it really resonated with me when I wrote my sermon notes, like I said, that are sitting on my nightstand. So, I'm just going to have to rely on what I felt God was telling me before that. And when I say when God was telling me, I mean in my spirit when I was reading, I got the impression. I don't actually audibly hear God. Although if I do, I'll tell you all about it. But I'll make sure I specify that's what I'm talking about so you can know how to discern what I'm saying. So this is actually in John. I was going to start at verse 27. But Jesus is actually being questioned by some Greeks who I can only assume are God-fearers. This is a sect of Greeks that actually worship in synagogues and go to the temple to the court of Gentiles because they believe in the one true God. But they're not Jewish, so they follow a set of rules to show, well, I don't eat meat sacrificed to idols, and there was a few other rules that they had to follow. And then they were kind of welcomed on the outskirts of the Jewish community. So Jesus is actually talking to a group of people I feel falls into that. It just identifies them as Greeks. And he talks about how it's important. I'll go back a little further to verse 23. The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. The man who loves his life will lose it, while the man who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. So again, he's speaking to a Greek audience. And then he goes on to say, now my heart is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. And the crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to them. And I would like to just stop for a second. Heaven audibly speaks. And only some people perceive that as what happened. Others are like, nope, it was the thunder. Have any of you ever noticed that before? I'm always blown away by the humanity here. Because if suddenly we started hearing a voice from heaven speak, even in this room, one of you may be like, boy, the ceiling's making a strange sound. Because we know that that's not normal. Going back to when I said I felt this feeling in my spirit, if I hear God audibly speak, I'll let you know. So maybe even I'm a little bit cynical towards this. As someone who believes this happens, I'm still a bit cynical. So you have a group of Greek people that believe in God. And heaven speaks. And many of them perceive it to be thunder. But some of them are like, no, an angel's spoken. And that's pretty interesting that you have people that go both ways right here. Jesus said, this voice was for your benefit, not mine. Which makes me wonder, how often did Jesus hear voices from heaven? And that's just a thought that I'm not going deeper into that. I just want you to ruminate on that for a second. Now is the time for the judgment on this world. Now the prince of the world will be driven out, but I, when I am lifted up from this earth, will draw all men to myself. He said this to show what kind of death he was going to die. The crowd spoke up. We have heard from the law that the Christ will remain forever. So how can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is the Son of Man? Then Jesus told them, you're going to have the light just a little while longer. Walk while you have the light before the darkness overtakes you. The man who walks in the dark does not know where he's going. Put your trust in the light while you have it, so that you may become sons of light. When he had finished speaking, Jesus left and hid himself from them. Again, I think the reason I was most drawn to that section of John is because he's talking about being lifted up again and that he's going to draw all men to himself. This is, I feel like this just reinforces the analogy he made several chapters earlier, you know, nine chapters earlier when he calls himself the serpent in the desert. And even after Jesus had done all these miraculous signs in their presence, they still would not believe in him. This was to fulfill the word of Isaiah the prophet. Lord, who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For this reason they could not believe, because as Isaiah says elsewhere, he's blinded their eyes and deadened their hearts, so that they can neither see with their eyes nor understand with their hearts, nor turn, and I would heal them. Isaiah said this because he saw Jesus' glory and spoke about him. Yet at the same time, many even among the leaders believed in him. But because of the Pharisees, they would not confess their faith for fear that they would be put out of the synagogue, for they loved the praise from men more than the praise from God. I think we see this very strongly among our leaders, within the church and without of the church. They care far more about what men say about them than what God thinks about them. There are probably 500 million shades of gray that you can find in Scripture. And then there are very clear black and white passages. It's really important to know where you stand sometimes. But what I find, and it's something that I battle against, and I guarantee almost all of you battle against the same thing, is it more important for you to stand correct before God, or is it more important for you to stand correct in front of other people? Because the gospel is offensive to those who are dying. Scripture tells us that. I'm not telling you to go out and offend everyone. Please don't. I believe everyone does need to be offended in life, but it is not always our job. Some of us would really enjoy it if it was our job to offend others all the time. I don't believe it's a spiritual gifting, but I do believe everyone is intended to be offended a certain amount in life. It helps us to grow. It helps us to know what we believe and what we should believe. It is not always our job to offend people, but when God allows you to, make sure it counts. You don't ever want to attack a person. You can show somebody the truth. Be like, hey, you just drank poison, without berating them first. If you're trying to save somebody, approach really helps. Although there's probably a time to berate someone, I've just never had it. I've done it before, but I know it wasn't God. Then Jesus cried out, when a man believes in me, he does not believe only in me, but the one who sent me. When he looks at me, he sees the one who sent me. I've come to this world as a light, so that no one who believes in me should stay in darkness. That's incredibly important, too. We have this very odd belief about our salvation sometimes, and I've helped perpetuate this. Many of you have as well, where you treat your salvation as an event. And an event is an important starting place for your salvation sometimes. But you should never treat your spirituality, your sanctification, your entire religious life as an event that happened when you were 13 or 5 or whatever age. Because it says, no one who believes in me should stay in darkness. I'm not saying everyone who has that event. You can tell the people that came to faith and then they changed their life, or God changes their life, or they allow their life to be changed. You can also tell people that live however they want to, and then when you ask them about it, they're like, oh yeah, I got saved when I was 13. But they have no fruit in their life. I'm not doubting their salvation. I don't have to. It's not my job. It really isn't. But I do know Scripture says that you don't continue to dwell in darkness. If you tell people you're a Christian and they're surprised, you're probably dwelling in darkness. Or you're really good at science and they didn't think that that was possible. But aside from those two scenarios, because for some reason people think that God is the enemy of science, and that's ridiculous. I'll try not to bring that up very often, but it does just festers under my skin. It makes me angry. Brush that chip off and keep going, I guess. As for the person who hears my words and does not keep them, I do not judge him, for I did not come to judge the world, but to save it. There is a judge for one who rejects me and does not accept my words. That very word which I spoke will condemn him on the last day. For I do not speak of my own accord, but the Father who sent me commanded me. What I say and how I say it, I know that his command leads to eternal life. So whatever I say is just what the Father has told me to say. So when Rob was speaking last week and he was giving that account, and he came through John 3:14 and he read the verse about how Jesus was lifted up like the serpent in the desert, my brain went nuts, as those of you who have known me for more than 5 minutes realize happens. And I just became incredibly fixated on how important it is that we see Jesus as our immediate salvation. In this moment, it is what saves us from the venom, the poison, the sin that is just coursing through our veins. Because if I wake up tomorrow and I decide not to live as a Christian for that day, I can't imagine that at this point in my life, but if I decided that, I think I would be sick. Because I have the realization that I, left to my own devices, will die sooner than later. The solution is still the same. We're to fix our eyes where God has told us to fix our eyes. God has lifted up Jesus for us to look at. For our healing, for our salvation, for life itself. All right, I'm going to go ahead and pray, and we'll move on with the service. If you're able to stand without pain, please do. Father God, I thank you for the opportunity to read from your word today. I pray that something I said will matter. Father God, I pray that your words would resonate, not my ideas. Father God, I thank you for each of the people that are here and those that are watching. I pray for those that we love, that we know aren't going to watch. Pray that you would help us to know how to be Christ for the world around us. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, that actually brings us to our time of announcements, and I am still new at this, So I did not have the foresight to ask someone to come do the announcement time. So really, I went from there to here to staying up here. And I apologize for that. I will try to do better next week. I am preaching again next week, and then Rob will preach the 2 weeks after that. So Rob is still your pastor. He will be back. Are there any announcements? A frisbee. That is great. I do love that barn, though. It's pretty neat. Again, if you didn't hear, youth will be at Jared Ohl's house, which is the antique-looking mail pouch barn on the way to Sparty from Corey. And bring a frisbee. We have a opportunity to serve among the community coming up. Ron Troyer's neighbor has a roof that needs done. I know this week Jake went and looked at it. I didn't get a chance to talk to Jake yet, though. Does that look like something we can help with? Wonderful. So we will plan, if you're able to, on Friday and Saturday to come give a hand. We can talk after service, but I would like to try to do that. There's also going to be some material costs, and I would like to ask your opinion on that now. We raised some money for the swap trip that got canceled. Would it be okay if we used some of those funds to help on the roof? Does anybody feel in favor of that? Go ahead and raise your hand. Okay, now go ahead and put your hand down. Does anyone feel very strongly opposed to that? Or just slightly opposed? Does it rub you raw? Okay. All right, thank you very much. I know I blindsided you with that. It's nice to have a little processing time, but we only have so much summer left. Are there any other announcements?
Sue got the Commonplace Center in March, right before we closed church. Mm-hmm. So she asked me to distribute these. I put some back on the table in the foyer and some out here on this little table by the back door. So if you'd like to get this, pick a copy up on your way out the door, okay? Thank you.
Are there any other announcements? Right. And what day is that again?
It is the 20th.
The 20th. Okay. Wonderful. Any other announcements? All right. I guess that brings us to our time of sharing and prayer requests.